Good morning, one and all. Welcome to our worship on this 24th Sunday after Pentecost, year A. The propers are for proper 20, year A. Those who are viewing, welcome. Join us, invite a friend, get your liturgy, and be prepared to give God honor and glory. For God is good, and His mercy endures forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Welcome. All instruct him.
Hymn 557. O God, who is the breath of life.
On page 100, the Book of Common Prayer, and following. Grace to you and peace from God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. Worship the Lord, the beauty of wholeness. The whole earth stands in awe of him. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia.
And blessed is his kingdom now and forever. Amen. Alleluia, alleluia.
Blessed God and Father, we have assembled in your name
and in fellowship with one another.
Enable us by your grace to offer the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, to proclaim and respond to your holy word.
Teach us to pray for your word and your church. Grant that we, confessing our sins, may worthily offer to you our souls and bodies as a living sacrifice, and eat and drink of your spiritual food in this holy sacrament. Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, We worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Today is Mother's Union Corporate Sunday. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Blessed Lord, who caused all Holy Scriptures to be written for your learning, grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of eternal life, which you have given us in your Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The prayer for the parish, page 79, number 14. Thank God for the opportunity to be here and for the family of St. Paul. We pray together.
Almighty and ever-living God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, hear our prayers of this parish family. Strengthen the faithful, arouse the careless, and restore the penitent. Grant us all things necessary for our common life, and bring us all to be of one heart and mind within your holy church, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
We are praying for Mother's Union prayer. Remain standing as our sister will read or pray the Mother's Union prayer. As we celebrate the Mother's Union of our parish, we are corporate communion this morning. The ministry of the word, the Old Testament reading.
Judges, chapter 4, verses 1 to 7. The Israelites again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord after Ehud died. So the Lord sold them into the hand of King Jabin of Canaan, who reigned in Hazor. The commander of his army was Sisera, who lived in Harosheth Hagoyim. Then the Israelites cried out to the Lord for help, for he had 900 chariots of iron and had oppressed the Israelites cruelly 20 years. At that time, Deborah, a prophetess, wife of Lapidoth, was judging Israel. She used to sit under the palm of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim, and the Israelites came up to her for judgment. She sent and summoned Barak, son of Abinoam, from Kedesh in Naphtali, and said to him, "The Lord, the God of Israel, commands you, go, take position at Mount Tabor, bringing 10,000 from the tribe of Naphtali and the tribe of Zebulun. I will draw Sisera, the general of Jabin's army, to meet you by the Wadi Kishon with his chariots and his troops, and I will give him into your hand." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm appointed for today, Psalm 123, found on page 642. Psalm 123, found in the Book of Common Prayer at page 642. The psalm will be led by our choir.
A reading is taken from the first letter of Paul to the Thessalonians, chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. Now, concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written for you, for you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman. And there will be no escape. For you, beloved, are not in darkness, but the day to surprise you like a thief. For you are children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So then, let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep at night and those who are drunk get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. The word of the Lord.
God. The sequence hymn, 560. 560, Great God of Earth and Heaven.
Thank you. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Matthew chapter 25, verse 25 to 40, from 14 to 30. Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven will be as when a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." And the one with the 2 talents also came forward, saying, "Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, "Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid and went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours." But the master replied, "You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return, I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to one with the 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have and abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. The Gospel of Christ. I share some thoughts with you in the name of the living God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Next Sunday, the church will celebrate the feast of the Christ the King Sunday. The year is almost done. We're just there. In fact, where did the time go? It was as though we just started. We seem not even to get off the ground this year. We just blinked and the year is over. And by the time we celebrate Christ the King, we will go into Advent of year B, and we will again be expecting, looking out in preparation for the coming of the King. Yes, we've had COVID. Yes, we've had these challenges during the course of this year. And the pandemic has it has frustrated many of the well-intended plans of 2020. We had all our arrangements. We were going to go abroad. We were going to visit. We were going to fix the house. We were going to buy a new car. We were going to get promotion or jobs. And all of a sudden, like that, it just disappeared in front of our eyes. It called us out. What was our response to some of these challenges? This different year. It is as though to remind us, despite our best efforts, we're not in charge. This is not ours. We go about our lives operating as though, okay, we can do this and we can do that. And yes, it's important to make plans, but remember to take them before the Master. Psalm 127. Unless the Lord blesses the work, they labor in vain who build the house. And this lesson from Matthew is a powerful reminder that we are stewards. Whatever we have, whatever we plan to do, is really, we take them before the Lord to ask his blessings. And always remember that we are to give account. We say the Apostles' Creed every time we have a service, morning and evening prayer, our Eucharistic service, and then we talk about, and he shall come to judge the living and the dead. But we go over those words as though they mean anything. And it should be a powerful reminder to us that one day we will have to face the Master who has gifted us with these talents that we are to use. And notwithstanding our own plans, part of the journey is to ask, Lord, what would you have of me? But as soon as we've had that conversation, we are to go out and to engage the world, because as we have witnessed, as we have experienced, there's a lot of work to do. Those of you who are family and friends, particularly who live in those countries, United Kingdom, the United States, understand the uncertainty which they are living on during these times. But even here in Trinidad and Tobago, we are experiencing frustration in homes. We are told that the rates of divorce have gone up. We talked about children being abused. We talked about financial abuse. And all of these things going on because the circumstances have changed. And our question that we are being asked today out of this lesson, what is our response? What are we doing with our talents? During this year, we've looked at the book, the Gospel according to Matthew. And of course, we know, we go via St. Paul's and we know our scripture, we know that Matthew has five discourses. So we start with the first discourse, with the Sermon on the Mount from chapter 5 to 7. And here, we are talking about the last discourse, where Jesus is talking about the end of the age. Prepare. It will come to an end. And then you have to give account. What was our preparation? What is our preparation? During the time that we've had to be home, because we're not moving about as much, we have to prepare, we have to take precautions. I had a chance to engage the what my mother used to call the idiot box. We respectfully call it the television and so forth. And I learned a new term from the U.S. general elections, the presidential elections. I learned the term RINO, which for those of you who don't know, means Republican in name only, RINO. And I asked myself, what about us? Are we SINOs? Are we Christians in name only? Because if we seek to follow the Master's will, if we seek to engage, if we seek to an understanding of what is we are being told, then we ought to be seeking to use the talents we are given. The kingdom of God is like this. Last week we read from chapter 25, verse 1 to 13, where Jesus was telling his disciples what to expect regarding the place that will be going. Because he's preparing us, he's teaching us. And his mission, I'm not going to argue with the theologians this morning, but his purpose is to fulfill the Father's will, to get you back in that relationship, that right relationship with God. You might say reconciliation if you want. Incidentally, that's one of our core values in our church, reconciliation. Bringing about that right relationship again, restoring, restoration, and doing the work of the Father. And this week's account, taken from Matthew, continuing from where we left off last week, where we head to chapter 25, verse 14 to 30, well known, the parable of the talents, the actions which make the story powerful and so timeless, come together, where we are told in this particular reading, the one who had received the five talents went off at once and traded with them and made five more talents. In the same way, the one who had the two talents made two more talents. But the one who had received the one talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. Typically, in the past, we have tended to focus on the wicked, lazy slave who buried the talent in the ground because he was afraid. And we have tended to highlight at times the admonition, the buff, the calling to account, the consequence of not using our talent. And that might be fair. That might be fair. There is accountability after all, and we are stewards, and we just talked about that. In fact, last night, as we talked about this particular lesson, one person asked a very important question, and I don't understand that lesson, you know, because poor people have what the economists call risk aversion. If I have a little bit, I'm not going to part with it with the chance that I might lose it, and that's fair. I too, over time, have struggled with what it is God is asking us to understand in this. And it came to me after struggle. We are talking here about God's way. not our understanding, but how God understands for us to operate towards his kingdom. So that whereas we appreciate risk aversion, if I have $10, I'm not going to go and try to see, well, there's a natural economic response. But remember what God tells Job, my thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are not your ways. God calls us to his kingdom. He came as King of Kings and Lord of Lords as a poor baby. And we will talk about that later on down the road. Turn the whole thing upside down on his head. And therefore, in the kingdom of heaven, he expects that everybody who has been given a talent, whether it's one talent, whether it's five talents, whether it's 100 talents, use them. Use them for building up the kingdom. So I want to talk today a little bit, not too much time, to spend looking at the talents, the slaves who use their talents. As I said, we need to talk about that risk aversion, and we need to understand what that is saying, and we need to understand the response of the master. But today there's a powerful lesson, there are powerful lessons coming out of the response of those who went out and invested. And it's by my thoughts and by the inspiration provided to me, is by no means exhaustive. If I forgot something, well, you could share it with me. Those who went and invested the master's money, his talents, well, however you see them, whatever they have been gifted with, they recognize the talents as belonging to the master. Not mine. It's a gift. And that at some time, they will have to be handed back in good order. And that should speak to us as well too. What are our talents? And how are we preparing to hand them back? What are we doing about that? Scripture tells us in Matthew chapter 25 verse 16 that the slave went away at once. At once. He didn't hang around. He didn't, I'll do that tomorrow. Let me look and see what the stock market doing. Or let me look at it. At once, because I have work to do. My dear people of God, do we have work to do here? Do we have stuff that we have to do? And not for ourselves, but for the master. Do we have a kingdom to build? Do we have a community to serve? Do we have people to help? And if the answer is yes to even one of those, then like the slaves, we have to go out right away. They went out. We have no indication that he hung around. Romans, Paul in Romans chapter 12 verse 6 tells us, we have gifts given according to the grace given to us. And again in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul tells us that there are a variety of gifts, and each given according to the manifestation of the Spirit. You have gifts. I have gifts. Your gifts are not my gifts. My gifts are not your gifts. Each and every single one of us has a gift that we are, or gifts, many gifts that we are given and we are called to use for building up the kingdom. The first slave invested his talents, and they grew, and they grew. We don't know how they grew, but they grew. Paul, again, the great apostle, tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, so neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives growth. When we use the talents that God gives us, when we trust in God, when we submit to him, when we ask him to guide us, despite our fears, despite our anxieties, despite our tendency to want to max it out, to work out how this is going to work. Despite our own limitation, God makes it grow. We don't know how. We don't know why sometimes. Sometimes only in hindsight we get it. But God, doing His will, makes it grow. And that's why it's important for us to use our talents, because that's what God wants us to do. And it makes a difference. During the, on the 1st of July of every year, using the book Holy Women, Holy Men, we celebrate the life of Harriet Beecher Stowe, who wrote a novel many centuries ago, Uncle Tom's Cabin. Perhaps some of you have read it. And in the book, she brought attention to the injustice of Black Americans at the hands of their slave masters under the yoke of slavery. I don't know that she intended to do that. I don't know that she set out to make money or anything. She came from a religious Christian family, and she felt moved by the injustice that she perceived taking place of these persons, these human beings, God's creatures, and she decided to write a book to express her own sentiments about what was taking place. And the book went viral. According to Bishop Michael Curry, if it was today, it would have been on Facebook and on YouTube, and it would have gone viral, millions of hits, because it touched the hearts. That's God's work. She just wrote a book. Abraham Lincoln, and that's in the, this is in the book of the Holy Women, Holy Men, is alleged to have said, when he met Harriet Stowe, little tiny woman, he said, and he looked at her, "So this is the little lady who started the Great War. This is the little lady who started the Great War by writing a book to express her feelings, by using the talents that God gave to her. One little act, and it broke open a hole, if you like, a dam full of sentiments. That's the way God's love is. That's the way God works. It only takes a spark, as we sing in our hymns. And you see God unfolding His intention because we do what we are called to do, as little or as insignificant in our eyes as it might be, using the talents that He gave us, not hoarding the talents, not holding back because of our own security or because we can't understand how this is going to take place. Just do it. Just submit yourself to God. It's not your work, it's God's work. Do your part. Allow God to use us, use our talents. And those little things that make the big difference, a kind word. You go to a store and you engage the customer service representative. And because you're spending your money, they have to understand who's in charge here. The customer is always right. And they receive the lash of your indignation because why have to wait so long? With no idea about where that person came from or what they may be carrying or what they have to face. A kind word, a thought. How are you doing today, dear? You know, everything all right? And God changes everything because you use that talent. That's how it works. And we don't understand it. I was deeply moved, you know, as I said, okay, we have to find ways of using the time that God has provided for us during this lockdown. So, of course, I talked to my wife afterwards, watching all the the clips on YouTube and other places. And I was deeply moved by a particular clip that I saw when the full set of acknowledgments of the victory of the Biden-Harris team came. And notice I'm choosing my words carefully. When the first set of acknowledgments of the Biden-Harris team's victory in the U.S. presidential elections. I'm not making any declaration about who won. But one of the media persons there who made it, was engaging us, was giving a story about talking to her young son. I think he might have been about 6 or 7 years old, somewhere around there. And she was telling this 6-year-old or seven that Senator Kamala Harris was to be the next Vice President of the United States. And he said to her, "But mom, she's a woman." To which she responded, "Yes, she is. Yes, she is." To which he responded in his own childlike innocence, "Does that mean that one day you could be vice president also?" Now understand this, we're not talking about gender here, we're not talking about sex or anything like that. We are talking about the unlocking of a possibility, of a hope, because of one little word, of one little example given and pointing it out. The possibility of a new world, of a different circumstance, because we did something that we were called to do, that we used our talents. No doubt there are millions of others like him. So that any tiny act on our part, as small as it might be, submitted to God, in deference of God, in response to God, changes everything. Everything. We can talk about the worthless slaves' actions to invite, to respond at another occasion, about being thrown into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. It's important. Jesus wants us to know what we are forsaking when we give up our opportunity to be part of the kingdom of God. But for now, let's focus on the wonderful opportunity to work with him and to bring about change in his kingdom right here, right now, starting today. If we can commit to using our talents in the service of the Almighty. There's so much to be done. There's so much to be done. In my conversations with our rector, the archdeacon, members of the vestry, and indeed members of our parish, we have so many, some of them big, some of them we want to go to cost a lot of money, some of them going to cost a lot of effort, some of them are going to make us uncomfortable, even though they don't cost money. But we're called to do them anyway. And we are called to bring our talents. This morning, Mr. Limak was telling me about the times back in the day, the glory days of St. Paul, when the choir stall was full. And if you didn't come to practice, there was nowhere to sit. You had to sit in the congregation. What about your voice? What about anything? What about anything? What about everything? Lay it all before God. Because we have a kingdom to build. We have duty to perform. We have a calling to respond to today. And in our church, it's sorely needed. In our faith, to reach out, to encourage, to touch, and to reconcile, to heal, Remember, our task is not about the people sitting here. It is about going out there. Since I've been at St. Paul, one of the recurrent stories, I can't tell you actually, I'm not saying that I'm tired here of this story, but he always talks about the visitation program. And he's right. He's right. Because that too is Jesus' command. When did you visit me? When did you feed me? When did you clothe me? When did you help me? Now is not the time to be comfortable. And if COVID has done anything, it has reminded us, don't get comfortable. You have work to do, and I have given you talents to do. Why don't you use them? How are we going to use our talents, my dear people of God, going forward? Remember the two loyal slaves. If you don't remember anything from today, remember Harriet Beecher Stowe. God will grow our investment. God will grow our talents if we commit to use them. And He's waiting on you. He's waiting on me. Your move. In the name of the Father, and the Son, Holy Spirit. Amen.
Continue our worship. And we affirm our faith in the living God, recite the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God. God thanks for this opportunity to be gathered as the saints of earth. Thank God for His word, and may we be open to do His will in season and out of season. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In our minor eloquent cycle of prayer, we pray for the saints of Sion, for the bishop, clergy, and people of that part of God's kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
The diocesan cycle of prayer, we put the pastors and patrons of Tobago, for the clergy who served yet, and their bishop and ministry, this part of our diocese. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Thank you pray for our diocesan bishop Claude and his family, our retired diocesan bishops, all the clergy and laity of our diocese. We also pray for our prophet, for our Archbishop Howard Gregory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And we share the intercession on page 107. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church,
that we all may be one. That your name may be glorified by all people. That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments. That there may be justice and peace on the earth. That our words may find favor in your sight. That they may be delivered from their distress. Let light of God shine upon them.
And remember this time, Shepherd Bernard, the father of Bernard, who passed this Christ, be buried tomorrow. Pray that God will comfort the family, that Brother Theo will rest in peace and rise in glory. Rest eternal, grant unto him, O Lord,
and perpetual shining on him. May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Together we pray. Almighty God,
to whom all needs are known before us, help us to ask only what accords to your will, and the good things which we dare not, all in our blindness cannot ask. Grant us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Page 123, the Act of Penitence. Sisters and brothers, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth of God not in us. If we confess our sin, God is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sin and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Let us reflect this on our lives as we gather this Sunday morning, this new week, as families, as friends, as colleagues, members of the household of faith. As God is still cleanse us of all defilements. Leave our burdens at the altar. Let go and let God. This shall take time. Now use form B to make our confession. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you. In thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have not loved ourselves as we ought. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, Father, and upon all your saints, God's word and strength of God, and we would like to know you receive this God. Our Lord,
amen.
For me, give of God is justice, peace, and joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit.
These who thus serve Christ are acceptable to God and approved by others.
The peace of the Lord be always with you,
and also with you.
Can you have your seats? You're welcome, one and all. Do you have any visitors this morning? First time after a long time, any visitors? Okay, welcome, the Reverend Father Wendell and Mrs. Dan Gunard. Not as the type of terms we'd like to have them. And we pray God will strengthen Father Bernard and his family. You know, he and Brother Theo is rather close. And we offer our prayers to you, Father, and your family. We know it's not easy. You have told many of us that it's not easy, not your turn, to believe. To believe and reach out and trust the Lord. And in God's time, all will be well. So God, we pray for you. We have a notice about an upcoming event. Concert come up, brothers and sisters, once you are able. Please note, we'll have service Wednesday morning at 6 a.m. Wednesday morning at 6 a.m. as we try to reacclimatize. A notice for a September affair, sorry, November affair.
Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. I am just here to remind you of our November to Remember virtual high tea. That's on the 28th of November. It's a Saturday from 3 to 5. It's $100. You'll collect your plates at the parish hall between 11 and 1, and between 3 and 5 we'll have a concert for you. Next week, Sunday God's willing, we'll give you the information to log in for the concert. We promise you, you're going to enjoy it. We'd like you to remember the good old days, dress up nicely, decorate your table, sit down and have your tea. You can even send us pictures, that would be so nice. Even if you want to model for us, just send us little videos or snapshots, whatever you have. But it is a fundraiser for the church, and that's the most important thing. It is a fundraiser for our church. We need the money. Thank you.
Birthdays, anniversaries, Thanksgiving. We have a CPO is coming up. Yes, and my girlfriend, of course, here. You can't see any traveling unless you're going to Tobago or Miyaru. So, have no problem with that now. All those who usually go, you cannot go now. Birthdays, anniversaries, Thanksgiving.
Thank you.
heaven and